I told you before that we don't use CHARGE to make a diagnosis of CHARGE. So how do we make a diagnosis? The diagnostic criteria for CHARGE have evolved over the decades and are still a little bit different. Every clinician does things a little bit differently, but for the most part, we use major features and supporting features. So when we have individuals who have multiple birth defects and problems, the question is, how do we distinguish between one syndrome and another syndrome? So the major diagnostic features are those which are common in CHARGE, but relatively rare in other syndromes, and ones that are recognizable early in life so that we can make the diagnosis in babies and children rather than later on. Supporting features can be any number of things. Sometimes there's things that are very significant and very common in CHARGE, but also common in other syndromes. So they're less helpful in distinguishing, is it CHARGE or one of the similar syndromes? They may be things that are significant when they're there, but they're less likely to show up. Or they may be things that are actually unique to CHARGE, but either difficult to diagnose consistently or have later onset. So the clinical diagnosis is still the gold standard, and we do it with major features and supporting features. What are these major features? Well, instead of CHARGE, I sometimes refer to the major features as the five C's because I could get them into things that all start with C. And that is coloboma of the eye, coanal atresia or cleft palate, cranial nerve anomalies, characteristic ears, and CHD7 pathogenic variant or mutation. A pathogenic variant is the term that in genetics we have evolved to talk about what we previously referred to as mutations. They're changes in the DNA. Those terms are fairly interchangeable. And the genetic counseling paper that I mentioned earlier on has a table that includes a differential diagnosis, and that is, what other syndromes have features that overlap with CHARGE, and how do we distinguish between them? So you can look at that paper to see what other ones look a lot like CHARGE and what we're thinking of in any child that's being evaluated for possible CHARGE. The supporting features include congenital heart defects, problems with the trachea or esophagus, renal kidney problems, genital problems, typical dysmorphic features, especially the face, sometimes facial clefts like cleft lip, brain anomalies, growth retardation, including sometimes growth hormone deficiency, and behavioral characteristics, especially obsessive compulsive disorder and autistic behaviors. I'm going to now go through some of the major features in much more detail. And you need to have at least two of the major features to have a definite diagnosis of CHARGE. And by the same token, if someone has any two of those features, they should be evaluated for possible CHARGE syndrome. The first of these features is coloboma of the eye, and about 80% of people with CHARGE have colobomas. This can be in the iris, the retina, or the macula. What is a coloboma? Well, when the eye is forming, the eyeball forms and it comes around and it kind of zippers closed along the bottom. And if there's a problem with that zippering closed, if there's a gap in the zipper, you're going to end up with a coloboma or a cleft in the eye. And it can happen anywhere from the front of the eye to the back. If it happens all the way in the front of the eye, it's an iris coloboma, and that will give you a keyhole shaped pupil or a notch in the pupil that extends down through the iris, as you can see in this picture here. An iris coloboma doesn't affect vision, but what it does do is affect your reaction to the light. Normally your pupils restrict in reaction to very bright light so that you can go outside in the sunshine and not be bothered by it. If you can't constrict your pupil all the way, bright lights may bother you a lot, and a lot of these kids want to wear tinted sunglasses, maybe even indoors, and are very sensitive to light. If the coloboma happens farther back in the eye, that's in the retina, and that would be a retinal coloboma, and that's going to cause blind spots, visual field defects. And this picture of the retina here shows a lot of red area where there are a lot of blood vessels. And in the middle, there's a big white glob. That's the coloboma where there's a gap in the retina. And what that's going to do is give you a visual field defect. When there's a coloboma in the retina, it's going to be in the bottom part of the retina. And if you remember, your vision gets flipped. So something in the bottom part of the retina is going to affect your upper visual field. And this drawing is an actual visual field of a 16-year-old with a retinal coloboma. If you see a visual field drawing of someone who has normal vision, it's going to be round with a little blind spot. We all have a little blind spot in our retina where the nerves come together. You can see in this drawing that there's a big cut out of the upper field, and he's got a visual field defect up here. It's as though you're wearing a cap with a bill pulled down. You're not going to see anything up above. So what do kids do with that? How does that affect them? Well, they put themselves in positions where they can see things. So these kids will often be sitting and using the lower part of their visual field to see things that are up above them. When you're little, most everything is up above you. They may get upside down. They sometimes get in very unusual positions to use the vision that they have. And I think something that's important to think about, we talk about visual loss. It's not really, it's a difference, but for them, it's not really a loss. If I suddenly developed a coloboma, it would be a loss for me because I'm used to having this vision up here. They're used to not having it. And so they just accommodate and get into position so that they can use the vision that they have. It's just like I don't have eyes in the back of my head. So if I want to see something behind me, I'm going to move and move around so that I can get to where I can see what I want to see. So they don't have that. They move there. The problem comes in with everybody around them who expect them to have vision up there and present them things to them up here and don't realize that they're not able to access that information. They're not able to see it. Another thing about colobomas is the coloboma can be in the macula. That's the part of the retina that's responsible for central vision. And that will give you a central vision loss. And that means that you're going to need to use your peripheral vision down low and around the side to see things. So if someone has central vision loss, they're going to be using their peripheral vision, and it's going to appear that they're not making eye contact with you. They may be paying very close attention to you, but it doesn't look like it. The young lady in this picture also has a bilateral facial palsy, and that, which we'll talk about a little bit more about in a minute. And that means that she's not able to animate her facial muscles. It's a very bland expression. She can't smile. Her eyes are wide open. And if someone has central vision loss and bilateral facial palsy, it looks like they're looking off to the side and they're not paying any attention. And that may not be the case. They may be paying very close attention to you. So it's really important to understand what's going on with both the face and the vision to be able to understand what they are actually paying attention to. The second of the major diagnostic features is choanal atresia. And about half of all individuals with CHARGE have this. So it's a little bit less common, but when it's there, it's very helpful. The choani are the passages from the back of the nose to your throat that make it possible for you to breathe through the nose. Atresia means blockage. Stenosis means narrowing. Bilateral is both sides. Unilateral is one side. So you can have a blockage or a narrowing on one or both sides of the nose. And for diagnostic purposes, those of us who've been involved with CHARGE for decades have agreed that cleft palate can be substituted for choanal atresia. About 20 to 30% of people with CHARGE have a cleft palate. Embryologically, those are different things, but from a diagnostic point of view, you can use either one of them. So what does choanal atresia do for you? Well, if you have blockage of the nose, that's really, really important. Newborn babies are obligate nose breathers. If they can't breathe through their nose. If you don't prop their mouth open and force them to breathe through their mouth, they will suffocate. And I think this probably developed so the babies could breathe and eat at the same time. But it's a really important thing to know about early on and to fix and to manage very early. What they do for this is they surgically open it up, and this requires doing surgery, putting in what's called a stent. It's sort of a straw that stays in there, keeps it open while it heals around it, and it sometimes starts to close down, and they need to dilate it to open it up again. Children with CHARGE sometimes need multiple surgeries and multiple stent placements to keep it open for a long time. If someone has just a unilateral stenosis, that is a narrowing only on one side, that can be really hard to diagnose, because the only way you can diagnose stenosis is to stick different sized tubes up their nose and see what goes through. It's a very unpleasant thing to do to a baby, and so we often don't do that unless they're under anesthesia for some other reason. But a stenosis can still be important because it can cause a lot of ear problems and sinus problems and fluctuating hearing loss. So there can be consequences to that as well. So it's very helpful to know, even if it's just a narrowing. The third of the major diagnostic features are the cranial nerve anomalies. And this is a whole set of features. And if we take all of them together and say who has at least one of these, more than 95% of people with CHARGE have some kind of problem with at least one of their cranial nerves. And these can cause problems with facial palsy, feeding problems, anosmia, that is no sense of smell, and sensory neural hearing loss. Facial palsy is cranial nerve number 7. You remember that picture I showed you before of the young lady with a very bland, no facial expression? She has a bilateral facial palsy. So the facial nerve animates the whole side of the face. So when you smile or when you cry, your ears squinch up, your mouth smiles, your cheeks get lines in them, that whole thing is from cranial nerve 7. If you have a one-sided or unilateral facial palsy, you'll have a very lopsided face, especially when smiling or crying. If there's a bilateral facial palsy, there's no facial expression at all. And a bilateral facial palsy can also interfere with sound production, so speech may be even more difficult to understand beyond what you get from the hearing loss. The young lady there that's pushing her cheeks up, she knows socially that her mouth is supposed to change when she's smiling and she's happy. And so she's making it do that because her face won't do it all by itself. There have been children or people who have had nerve transplants where the doctors take a nerve from the leg and transplant it into the face to try and reanimate the face. That's been done successfully. It's not routinely done. And to illustrate really more dramatically, young lady with the bangs there that's smiling, I took her picture, and you can see her picture on her there, and I made a double right side and a double left side. So you can see the side that has the facial palsy, you can sort of tell that she's trying to smile, but her eyes are wide open. The smile sort of doesn't reach her eyes and is pretty bland. It looks like a fake smile. You look at the side that does not have a facial palsy, and you can see that the smile reaches the eyes and her cheeks and the whole thing. So you can really get a feel for how that would look if she were symmetric either way. Another cranial nerve anomaly are cranial nerves 9 and 10. And these are the cranial nerves that coordinate suck and swallow. And this is a very complicated system. And I'm not going to go into all the details, but just know that the swallowing problems are severe enough that, and 70 to 80% of people with CHARGE have issues with this. Many of them end up with gastrostomy tubes, where they have a tube that feeds them directly into their stomach. These issues usually get better over time, but it may last for years, and there are still some adults who are still fed by gastrostomy tube because they're not able to take food by mouth without choking or getting it into their lungs or things like that. And many of the adults with CHARGE have told me that they still avoid certain textures because they have trouble getting them with the chewing and sucking and swallowing. And choking remains a possible hazard for even adults with CHARGE. Other complications that go along with the swallowing problems is aspiration. If instead of going down the esophagus, food is going into the trachea and getting into the lungs, that's aspiration. And aspiration pneumonia is a very common cause of hospitalization in children with CHARGE. Gastroesophageal reflux is very common. In addition to surgery to put in a gastrostomy tube, many need to have sort of the top of their stomach tied off so that things doesn't go up and down the esophagus. So oftentimes need a lot of surgical management for that. Getting kids to eat orally can take years and lots of therapy. The last cranial nerve I'll talk about is cranial nerve number one, and that is the sense of smell. And this is very, very common in CHARGE. It's really difficult to test for sense of smell in children, but the best tests that we have for CHARGE say that half of the children with CHARGE have no sense of smell at all. The other half have a decreased sense of smell. So having normal sense of smell would be extremely uncommon in people with CHARGE. And you think about smell, the sense of taste in CHARGE is probably normal or near normal, although we haven't specifically tested that. But most of what we refer to as taste, or maybe flavor is a better word for it, is actually smell. And if you think about when you have a cold and your nose is stuffed up, food tastes really bland because all you're tasting is sweet, sour, salt, bitter, the stuff that you taste, not the stuff that you smell. And so that further complicates getting these kids to eat orally because it's not very pleasant, there's not much reward to it, and so on. In addition to issues with feeding, lack of a sense of smell has some safety implications. Think smoke, spoiled food, that kind of thing. One young woman said, who lives completely by herself, said, well, I just put dates on my leftovers, and after a certain amount of time, I just throw them away because I can't smell it until if it's gone bad. There are also social implications for no sense of smell. Think smelly feet, body odor, passing gas. One young woman I know was a resident at the school for the deaf. She was a teenager. She had a lot of issues with passing gas. She couldn't hear it. She couldn't smell it. She could feel it, but she had no idea that other people around her were aware that this was going on, much less that it was unpleasant for them, that it smelled bad, that it was a not nice experience for them. She had to very specifically be taught, when you feel that, other people are smelling something that's very unpleasant. And since she doesn't smell at all, that was a really hard concept to get across to her. That's some of the incidental learning that I'll mention later. You usually don't have to teach kids about that. They figure it out by how other people react and by their recognizing things. Well, if your experience of the world is different because you're not smelling things, you're not going to understand the reactions of other people. So the lack of sense of smell may not seem like a big deal, but from a social standpoint, it really can be. The next of the major diagnostic features is the characteristic CHARGE ears. And again, this is actually a set of features because it can be the outer ear, the middle ear, or the inner ear. And if we look at all of those, about 95%, the vast majority of people with CHARGE have some issue somewhere in their ears. The outer ears of CHARGE may be completely normal, or they may be very close to normal, where only a medical geneticist would notice any different, or they could be so distinctive as to say, I've seen a couple kids where I've seen their ear and said, that child has CHARGE until proven otherwise, because nothing else gives you that ear. So what characteristics do we see in these ears? One of the things that I really notice is asymmetry between the two ears. Sometimes one ear looks very typical, the other ear looks very unusual, or sometimes they both look unusual, but they don't usually look like each other. So asymmetry between the ears. They're often very floppy because of deficient cartilage. One mom described her child's ears as kind of blowing in the wind. As far as their shape, they're often short and wide, and there can be a clipped-off helix. The helix is the outer fold of the ear, and the yellow arrow here is pointing to an ear that has that is missing that outer fold of the helix. One of the most common things we see and easiest to evaluate is a smaller absent earlobe, as you see with the green arrow. And another thing we describe is a triangular concha. The concha is like conch shell. It's the shell in part of the ear. And because the antihelix, the inner fold of the ear, can be very, very prominent, you can end up with a very significant triangular shape to the inside of the ear, as you see on the ear that's showing the blue triangle there. Sometimes all the folds of the ears are kind of missing, and you end up what can be described as a cup ear. So we see all sorts of different things with the outer ear. Seeing the outer ear does not predict what's going on in the middle or the inner ear. You can have a normal outer ear and be completely deaf, or you can have an abnormal outer ear and have much less hearing loss. There's really no correlation between the outer and the middle and the inner ears. This is a diagram of the inside of the ear, of the middle and inner ears. And the middle ear is the part that is right behind the eardrum. So there's the eardrum, and right behind it are three little tiny bones. And the eardrum moves, and that vibrates the bones. And those bones then send the message to the hair cells in the cochlea for hearing. Those little bones may be missing. They may be malformed. There may be a lot of fluid in there gunking them up so that they can't move. Any of those situations will cause what is called a conductive hearing loss. When we move to the middle ear, or to the inner ear, excuse me, in the inner ear, one of the most significant things are the semicircular canals. And those are three fluid-filled loops that constitute the vestibular system, or the balance part of the inner ear. And probably the most common feature of CHARGE syndrome is small, malformed, or absent semicircular canals. You can see this best by MRI, can also be seen by CT scan, but many children don't get imaging of the middle ears, the inner ear. They get imaging of their brain maybe, but not all the way down to their ears. So we often simply don't have that information. If there's a question of charge in someone, that's something I always recommend. Knowing about the semicircular canals is helpful in that it can help confirm the diagnosis. It's also helpful to know that if the vestibular system is not there, because that will help you know that there's going to be a lot of delay in motor development, because you'll hear a lot more about this later on, but balance uses the vestibular system, your vision, your proprioception, information from your muscles and joints, and your brain all put together help you balance. If you're missing that major component of the vestibular system, you have to figure out ways to use all the other information to be able to balance, and that's going to take longer. The next part of the inner ear is the cochlea. And that is the snail-shaped organ in the inner ear that contains the hair cells. That's the information that gives you the sensory neural hearing. In typical people, that cochlea will have 2.5 turns to it. In individuals with CHARGE, the cochlea often has only 1.5 turns, resulting in a sensory neural hearing loss. Information goes from the cochlea to the brain via the cochlear nerve, also called the auditory nerve. And in people with CHARGE, that nerve may be hypoplastic, which means underdeveloped, or aplastic, which means it's not there, it's absent. And if you look at in that red circle, there's the cochlear nerve, and sitting right on top of it is that facial nerve that I talked about earlier. That facial nerve goes through the inner ear. If someone's being evaluated for a cochlear implant, it's really important to know where the facial nerve is. It sometimes goes in an odd place in kids with CHARGE. So you don't want to damage that in the process of putting in a cochlear implant. A little bit more about the inner ear balance problems. If you have small or absent semicircular canals, you are missing a major portion of the vestibular system that gives you the your balance and your information about where you are in space. And that results in some fairly characteristic gross motor development early on. So when kids are crawling, they're going to want to stay close to the ground. They may do a combat crawl, sort of going along on their tummies, or a lot of them crawl on their backs and push with their legs. Sometimes if they are up there on their hands and knees, they put their head down for another balance point. We call that a 5-point crawl. They may do bottom shuffling. And we've always known that the age of independent walking in charge is very delayed, but the balance really explains a lot of that. If you look at typical children, when they hold a stand and they're cruising, walking along, holding on to furniture, it's about 2 months before they let go and are able to walk independently. If you look at children with charge, and when they pull a stand and they're walking along, holding on to furniture, cruising, holding on to hands, that kind of thing, it's more than a year before they're able to let go and walk independently. And that's because of that balance information. They're not getting all the information. They're having to learn to use other information from their bodies to figure out where they are. And so that's going to really delay their walking. It has nothing to do with their intelligence. It has to do with their physical system and the balance issues. Beyond that, the vestibular system is also important for processing visual information and auditory information. If you think about when you turn your head, the image doesn't jerk along, it goes smoothly, and you can do that. That's because your vestibular information is telling you where your head is in space. So when you don't have a vestibular system, it's going to change your visual information and your auditory information, even beyond where your visual field defects are or what your hearing loss is. So that vestibular system is really important, and you will hear more about that later on in this lecture series. The last of the major diagnostic features is the genetics, CHD7 pathogenic variants or mutations. And about 80 to 90% of people with charge have pathogenic variants in CHD7 that we're able to identify with current technology. That's changed as the technology has gotten better, but it's probably never going to be 100%. Typically, these are what are called unique missense variants. Okay, what does that mean? Unique means it's the only one. It's a very large gene. You can have changes anywhere in it. There are no hotspots. For some genetic conditions, you can say, if we look at this part of the gene, we'll find half of all the changes that exist. That's not so with charge. They can be anywhere, and finding a change that's never been reported before is actually very common. Missense means that it's a change in the DNA that makes a protein that isn't going to be functional, as opposed to that you can have missense and nonsense and all different kinds of variants. And these are basically typos in the DNA. I'll say a little bit more about that in a minute. But I also want to say that there really isn't any correlation between the variant, the mutation that you find, and the features that you find. So you can't say, oh, if you have a change right here, you're going to have this kind of heart defect. Charge doesn't work that way. You can't predict it that way. And that kind of goes along with it not running true in families. Two people in the family, they have exactly the same change in the CHD7 gene, it's showing up differently. So you really can't say what's going to happen based on what kind of change that you find. A little bit more about the gene. It's a very large gene. CHD7 has nearly 200,000 base pairs. The base pairs are the A, T, G, C that make up DNA, sort of the spelling of the DNA. And what you're looking for is a single typo in that string of 200,000 base pairs. And the only way to find that is by specifically sequencing, reading every single base pair. So there are a lot of different kinds of genetic tests. Chromosome tests, microarray, many of those tests are not going to tell you about CHD7. So if someone has they have genetic testing and it was normal. I always have to ask them, which type of genetic testing did you have? Because there's no one test that will give you all the information about all the different genetic conditions.